In 1958, I accepted an appointment as professor of medical psychology at Columbia University's College of Physicians and Surgeons. One of my first duties after I arrived was to hire a research psychologist, Dr. Helen Schuckman, for a major research project in our department. Helen and I worked together very closely over the next 7 years on a wide variety of professional, administrative, and clinical problems. And while for the most part our work was, I would say, well done, there was also a sense of frustration and conflict in our personal and professional relationships. One day I felt I had had it, and I said to Helen unexpectedly, "There must be another and better way of working in this world, and I'm determined to find it." To my great surprise, Helen said, "You're absolutely right, Bill. We'll find it together." This collaboration served as a trigger for Helen to hear an inner voice, which dictated an extraordinary answer to our search for a better way. It came as a 1,500-page self-study course in spiritual development. It was called A Course in Miracles and was channeled through Helen for the 7 years between 1965 and 1972.
Listen. Perhaps you catch a hint of an ancient state not quite forgotten. Dim, perhaps, and yet not altogether unfamiliar. Like a song whose name is long forgotten and the circumstances in which you heard completely unremembered. Listen. Not the whole song has stayed with you, but just a little wisp of melody, attached not to a person or a place or anything particular, but you remember, from just this little part, how lovely was the song, how wonderful the setting where you heard it, and how you loved those who were there and listened with you. Listen.
One of my favorite quotations from the course is, "Two minds with one intent become so strong that what they will becomes the will of God."
A Course in Miracles became published very quickly, and it was actually ready on June 22, 1976. There were hundreds of people who had written in to ask about it, and we had no trouble distributing the first printing. In fact, our, again, inner guidance had very carefully instructed us that as a not-for-profit foundation holding the copyright of A Course in Miracles, we were not to conventionally advertise it, that people would hear about it in a low-keyed way, word of mouth, and that the best way to disseminate the course would be to let people demonstrate it. And that became our policy and our philosophy, which we still keep to this day. It has been quite amazing to me to see how the course travels with wings by itself.
I read one page, and in that one page of reading it, I heard for the first time in a little inner voice that said, "Physician, heal thyself. This is your way home." And I had the most amazing experience of feeling a sense of oneness with the whole world, that there was absolutely no separation, that there was only love. And a real feeling that I was to be of service to God. My whole life would be changed, and it'd be a life of giving and a life of being of service. I really couldn't understand that, but it was a very deep, penetrating feeling. And I became a student of the Course, fought it all the way, couldn't deal with the thickness of the Course, let alone its Christian terminology. And yet there was something about the Course that just compelled me to go on.
I encountered A Course in Miracles at a very critical time in my life when I was chief of the Foreign Affairs and National Defense Division of the Library of Congress and had 150 professional men and women working for me and for the Congress to clarify major issues of defense policy and foreign policy. And it was a very rich and full life, a very useful career, you might say, as far as informing Congress about different ways of looking at foreign and defense policy issues. But unfortunately, at precisely the time when, from an outsider's perception of me, my life seemed to be most useful, it had the least meaning.
I found it very threatening to incorporate these principles into my practice. First of all, I was concerned in those days about what other people might think of me. I didn't want someone to think I was a God freak or a Jesus freak. So I really didn't tell anybody what I was doing and wanted to keep that very quiet, very much to myself. And it took, I think, several months before I even shared this with people who were close to me, like my brothers and my children. I kept it that secret.
Several quotations became my guide, and I guess, in a sense, the one that was most startling for me was the quotation, "Do not seek to change the world, instead change your mind about it." Now, given the fact that my entire professional life had been dedicated to leaving the world a better place, in effect to changing some of the things that I thought were wrong with the world, and my technique for doing that was to try to understand economics, politics, strategy, psychology, sociology, the Chinese language. I had a great deal of education that aimed at being more useful. And yet as time went on, I became very clear that, as they say in Washington, where I stand on an issue depends on where I sit. So when I read this first quote in the course, it was something that, as people say in California, really resonated with me. It sounded true.
My interest in the Course in Miracles began some years ago when I was doing research at the University of California on meditation and different schools of religion. And someone showed me a copy of the course, and I reacted with great skepticism and refused to look at it for a couple of years. Until when I finally did, I was quite surprised and surprisingly impressed, particularly by two things. One was that I found there was a psychological system within it which was very sophisticated and on a par in many ways with some contemporary thinking in Western psychology. And the second thing that surprised and impressed me was that it became clear that this seemed to represent an example of the underlying perennial wisdom which seems to lie at the core of the world's great religions.
I believe that we in the modern Western Christian Church need to modernize our beloved yet now ancient Christian theology, because modern Christian theology is more a reflection of the opinions of Paul the Apostle and ancient Jewish theology than it is a reflection of the teachings of Jesus. In addition, 2,000 years of use and abuse have rendered the teachings of Jesus distorted. The improvement that I am suggesting brings us up out of the theological dark ages where God was seen as a killer. It reestablishes God's good name. It encourages us to play in His presence. In the Course in Miracles, it teaches that God is accessible at all times, in all places, to everyone unconditionally and everyone equally. God is available in our mind, in all places, at all moments, without restriction of any description. In its teaching, God is the guru, God is the teacher, God is the altar, God is the church, the synagogue, and the temple. God is everything, including the theology. God is the way, the truth, and the life.
When I first read in A Course in Miracles, the ideas that our home is in God's presence, that we are spirit and not the body, that we have been created as one with each other and our source, I just knew it was true. I'd had the experience. I didn't need validation of the experience to know it was true. But I did need an intellectual system to help me apply it. And that's what I first noticed about the Course. that I could start with a lesson a day to start to unlearn the mistakes that had been programmed into my mind, that I could remember more clearly that indeed I am spirit. And in that sense, I'm at home and totally safe. I don't have to go any place to find safety. I don't have to be anyone different. I just have to remember who I am.
Growing up in Louisiana, I really was never aware of any inequality. I came from a very large family. My mother and father basically worked for themselves. And very loving sisters took care of me. I really had no idea that some people really felt that they were better than others, or more than others. I came to UC Berkeley around 1967. It was very turbulent years at the school, a lot of racial strife. And around 1968, 69, I took a lot of courses in sociology, psychology, political science. And the theme in all of them was blacks were poor, blacks were deprived, blacks were, you know, the wretched of society. I began to look at life, the society, with anger and frustration. And around that same time, there was a group of people called themselves the Nation of Islam. And it basically taught black supremacy. And I lived this doctrine. I ate it. I slept it. I didn't really socialize with whites for 7 years. I never would go into their stores. We made our own clothes. We grew our food. Everything we did, I lived, ate, slept Islam. And one Sunday, I was looking for an apartment. And I was thumbing through the paper, and I saw a set of lectures at JFK in Orinda, University of JFK in Orinda. And something said, you need to go because Ann Armstrong is going to be there. And Ann Armstrong was this psychic, and I was really feeling like, well, I probably should get another perception of what's really going on in the world, what's really going on for me, because I was feeling the pull to look at things differently. So I went over to JFK, and I, like, you know, this is the very first, I hadn't been on the campus or in a white environment for 7 years. And when I got there, she wasn't there. It was a lady there named Judy Scutch, and she was introducing a set of books titled A Course in Miracles. And she was reading the introduction. And something happened inside of me that was very different. Very, very different. Because I remember I had gone into the lecture hall. The room was filled with Caucasians, whites, and I felt very, very self-conscious. You know, what am I doing in this large auditorium with all of these whites? So I moved down to the front row and put my head down and folded my arms and was really on guard, you know, and very paranoid, and very, you know, kind of somewhat frightened. But feeling like I had to be there for some reason. I didn't know why, especially as I knew that Ann Armstrong wasn't going to be there. And when Judy read this introduction, I had this experience that I hadn't experienced since I was a child. I was one with everything in the room. I felt totally at peace. And something deep inside of me said, this is a tool for you. Use it.
One of the concerns that a number of people have is how can we distinguish something like the Course in Miracles, which seems to be a genuine transcendental spiritual practice, from some of the much less sophisticated and sometimes dangerous groups that are around, including some of the cults that are so prevalent now. And it's interesting that recent research suggests a couple of ways in which we can distinguish among these different groups, and that the Course in Miracles seems to fit all the criteria for being a genuine spiritual discipline. The first is that it has no guru, and that people who practice it are thrown back on their own responsibility. They're told that ultimately the decisions have to be their own to make through accessing their own inner wisdom. So the source of wisdom, the source of authority is within rather than given to someone outside.
Nothing outside changed, but what's inside began to change. I began to see the love that was there between from human to human. I began to experience that. I began to get new friends who were not looked, that didn't just look like me, who were white, you know, who were Hispanic, or, you know, color became, did not, was not an issue in my relationships. I began to see that all men are created equal. And unless we see that, we're not going to experience peace. I began to see that anytime I see myself as being above another human being or below another human being, I'm not going to experience peace.
The Course is predicated on two belief systems. One is real, the other is false. The false belief system is one the ego adheres to, and that is that we're born into this world in physical bodies, in a world that is real, the physical, and things happen to us, and sometimes we experience happiness, once in a while joy, very often depression and anxiety, certainly disease, and always death. And that's the system of thought that the ego loves, the ego adheres to, the ego exalts, and the ego wants us to believe in. On the other hand, there's the belief system that God is our reality. We are created in God's image as spirit, not the physical body. That we are love, that a property of love is light, and that we are eternal. We cannot be hurt. We're inviolate. We can't be destroyed. When one puts it that way, who but an insane person would want to choose the ego?
This is a very exciting time because there are several things now happening which are enabling us to recognize the common core at the center of the world's religions in ways which we couldn't do a few years ago. Firstly, we have the world's religions available to us for the first time. So that's one exciting thing. The second is that we also have some new texts available from early Christian times which paint a very different picture of early Christianity and suggest that it was actually much more mystically based than we previously thought, and that some of its early teachings are quite consistent with some of the Eastern traditions. And given these facts, then the Course in Miracles seems to be consistent with some of the early Christian thinking. The third thing we have is a more sophisticated Western psychology now, which, due to its insights into, for example, the nature of states of consciousness, has enabled us to get a new understanding of the nature of religion. And for the first time in history, we can understand that religions, at their core, the world's religions contain roadmaps for training the mind to induce transcendental states of consciousness, the transcendental states of consciousness from which they probably originally sprang. And the Course seems to represent a contemporary Christian example of this perennial wisdom, or perennial philosophy as it's being called.
I would say that not only is the Course the most important book since the Bible, I think it's probably one of the most important books throughout the whole period of civilization. I think that it certainly purifies the Bible of a lot of its misconceptions and distortions. And I would see the Course really as being on a par with some of the great ancient texts, like the Upanishads or the Vedas or the I Ching, in a kind of a metaphysical purity of seeing the world as being an illusion, and yet also deals with how we should live in this world.
I have the greatest esteem for Dr. Wapnick and others, some of my close friends, and I reverence and esteem them personally. I would just like to get clarity on what's really going on, and that we don't mislead people thinking this is really Christianity, but just with a slight little touch of difference, it's something radically different, which is fine as long as you know it's different.
The Course claims to be a correction of Orthodox theology and Christianity, and I believe that it is. One of the major corrections is the belief that humans and God are separated. It obviously appears that we are. That is, it's like we can't see God here. We can't feel God. It appears that we have been stuck on earth against our will, that we are prisoners in these bodies, and we have no real way of connecting with God.
The essence of God, according to the Course of Miracles, is that God is pure spirit. And some of the characteristics of spirit is that it is perfect, it is limitless, it is infinite, and it is eternal. This also must mean that anything that comes from God, that God creates, must also share in those same characteristics or attributes. So that according to the Course in Miracles, Christ, who is defined as God's one Son, or the creation or the extension of God, must also share in these same attributes. So that Christ, too, must be pure spirit. He must be without form, must be infinite, perfect, and eternal. Since our true identity, as the Course teaches us, is Christ, is this pure essence of spirit, then this means that anything that is other than spirit, anything of the ego or of the body, must therefore not be of God, which then means that it does not exist.
The first thing that I find incompatible with any form of Orthodox Christianity, or Judaism too, is the doctrine of creation. That is to say, the traditional Christian doctrine is that God made the material world, God made it himself, and that it was very good. In the Old Testament it says, you know, after the first day's work and so on, God saw what he had made and that it was good, very good. Now, in the Course in Miracles declares that God did not create the material universe. It is a result of a splitting off of a part of the divine consciousness into an ego which separated from God, and that it's a kind of illusion. It is not the work of God as creator. So God is the first article of the creed, in the Christian creed, I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible, is denied, because God is not that, and God the Father doesn't even know about this material world.
The Course teaches that when we separated from God, which was still in our mind, the world of matter or form still had not come into existence. In order to escape from God's wrath, what we did was that we ran out of our mind, as it were, projected that thought of separation, and that projection then became the world. So that the world then is really seen as a large smoke screen, a hiding place in which we seek to conceal ourselves so God wouldn't punish us.
The second point of incompatibility I'd like to bring out with regard to Jesus is the fact that in the traditional Christian doctrine, Jesus is the eternal Son of God who then becomes man, takes on a real body and real flesh, as St. John puts it, and then is a redeemer by dying on the cross to forgive our sins.
It's been a hallmark of Christian thinking ever since the time of the first Gospels that Jesus was the only Son of God, and then, as St. Paul had said once, we're the adopted sons. So in a sense, we become second-class citizens. And what the Course very strongly teaches is that Jesus, again, is not the only Son. We are all part of the same sonship, that the only difference between ourselves and Jesus is that he was the first one to get through. In other words, he got smarter faster than anybody else. So that he then becomes like an older brother who reaches back to help everybody else do what he did.
Also, as part of this doctrine, the traditional Christian doctrine of the resurrection, where Christ has risen from the dead with a real body, and then will become, that has now become his glorified body forever, and all of us are called also to a resurrection of a real body, which will be part of our further happiness in heaven. Now, in the Course in Miracles, that of course can't be true. Jesus can't be risen in his real body because there is no real body. The body is an illusion. So he's returning to his pure spiritual state and nature.
There's a whole section in the Course at the beginning of chapter 6 where Jesus specifically talks about his crucifixion. And he says that in the eyes of the world, I was beaten, abandoned, torn, and finally killed. But then, as he says, this was not a perception that I shared for myself. He did not see a sinful world attacking him. He saw a fearful world crucifying him, believing that by getting him out of the way, then their own sins would be safe. And what Jesus says in several places in the text is he says, take me as your model for learning. That when we're tempted to see ourselves as being crucified by the world and as being victimized by the world, and most of the time under circumstances far less extreme than occurred with him, then we should remember what he did. Not that he was crucified and killed, but that rather that he did not share the perception that the world had, and that we should ask his help, that we look at the situation that is troubling us through the same eyes that he did. And again, that's what he means when he says, take me as your model. He also says in the text, teach not that I died in vain, teach rather that I did not die by demonstrating that I live in you. And the way that we demonstrate that he lives in us is not by standing up on a soapbox preaching or ramming the Bible or the Course down anybody's throat, but rather by demonstrating that the same principles of forgiveness that he lived by are the same principles we live by. And above all, to deny the temptation to see ourselves unfairly treated by the world. And that really is what the message of the crucifixion is.
A third point would be the doctrine of the Eucharist itself. Christians, especially Catholics, believe that the Eucharist is the real body and blood of Christ, which they receive as a nourishment and a spiritual nourishment and a sacrament. Now, in the Course of Miracles, that, of course, can't be true, because there is no real body of Christ. It has to be an illusion and not the real nature of Christ.
When I opened the text for the first time, I felt the presence of Jesus very strongly right by me as I was reading the opening pages of the text. And then I came across a statement that absolutely blew my mind, and that was that God did not create the world. And at that point, it was like Eureka. Everything fell into place. All my grievances against God just vanished, because I said, why didn't I even think of this? I mean, it's so simple. He didn't create this. We made this mess, and I've been blaming him all these years and holding this against him. And for me, that changed the rest of my life. Nothing was ever the same again.
I think the concept in the Course which gives most of us a lot of difficulty, and certainly was my most difficult concept, was the one about this world being totally illusory. And I think all of us have preferences for our illusions. We like to think that there are more beautiful illusions, more spiritual illusions, and then there are illusions at the bottom, which are, you know, the pits. And the Course is quite clear that this is all illusion. When I apply this in situations where things are not really going well, it's quite easy to say, oh, this is a terrible mess, but this is all illusion anyway, so it really doesn't make any difference. On the other hand, on a practical day-to-day basis where one has to cope with human psychology and living in this world, I find that it's helpful not to be terribly hard on myself in looking at my humanness. And the Course also speaks very fully about this in the teacher's manual, where it cautions us not to despair because of our limitations, because it says while it is our function to escape limitations, they will always be with us, because if we are to be heard by those who suffer, we must speak their language. If we are to be a savior, we must understand what we must escape from. And so not to be too concerned about goals for which we are not yet ready, to ask the important questions and to ask for help when we need it, and to sit silently knowing that we will receive the answers as much as we are able to accept them at the time for our level. So I think it's very important to be aware of our humanness and to know that the Course acknowledges that, and that we are not in these bodies because we are totally perfect, but we are in these bodies because we have lessons to learn.
Once you accept His plan as the one function that you would fulfill, there will be nothing else the Holy Spirit will not arrange for you without your effort. He will go before you, making straight your path and leaving in your way no stones to trip on and no obstacles to bar your way. Nothing you need will be denied you, not one seeming difficulty but will melt away before you reach it. You need take thought for nothing, careless of everything except the only purpose you would fulfill. As that was given you, so will its fulfillment be. This is an amazing promise. I found that after a while I wanted to rephrase the Course for myself. And so I took passages like this, and the most meaningful affirmation for me came to be one that I would recite as I went down the freeway or any other odd time in my daily life. But I have no other desire, no other ambition, no goal, no nothing. I have no other desire than to know the deepest part of myself and to follow that. And then this kind of statement says, if you do that, everything will be all right. Whatever you need, it will show up. Coincidentally, accidentally, whatever. If you want to know what should I be doing, what am I here for, what's really meaningful, it shows up.
When we say hear or listen to the voice inside, it's just a catchphrase to encompass so many different kinds of feeling. Sometimes I've had the experience of actually hearing, as if there was a voice, say, about over here. But that's been very rare, only 3 or 4 times in my life that I could remember. And then it was quite dramatic. I whirled around, I thought someone else was in the room answering a question I had just voiced. But most of the time, when I listen, the kind of hearing is a feeling. It's words, but the words feel right. They promise joining. They promise an all-win solution. They promise that which is peaceful. They promise love. When I'm not listening, through my higher voice. I'm listening to the ego. We're always listening. We know that feeling of dialoguing back and forth. Should I do this? No, I shouldn't. Should I do that? Yes, I should. When I'm listening to the smaller voice, it usually isn't peaceful. Most of the time, it's self-serving. Always is a tinge of fear, and it's never all win. I've become very familiar with that voice. In fact, I can say that I know it intimately as both my own and the higher. And sometimes I won't actually feel, hear, see words, but a book will be handed to me that explains the solution to a problem. I'll experience music that suddenly helps a mood change. Someone will call on the telephone with a piece of information or some advice that I needed and wanted, and I know that those are answers too. There's a line in the Course I absolutely love. It says, "Show the slightest willingness, and 1,000 angels rush in to help." And the angels are not just unseen. They're all around us, in many sizes and shapes, and they're each other.
Two of my favorite quotes from the Course are two lessons. Number 134, which is, "If I defend myself, I am attacked." And the other is 185, or 285, which is, "My mind can change all thoughts that hurt." These I have found of tremendous practical value in going through life. And I've also found that in dealing with other people, and especially when we go into the prisons and deal with people who are in prison, that these two lessons are very pragmatic, very practical, and are of tremendous value to those people who have found themselves in that situation.
In 1969, I was involved in several crimes which brought me to San Quentin, which became my home for 15 years plus. And the crimes were murder, kidnap, two armed robberies, and eventually a burglary, a violation of a probation that I'd previously had. My youth was kind of spent on the streets as a wild and rambunctious, bravado, scared asshole. My way of getting attention, as it turned out, was to get involved in crime. I had a kind of a exemplary life on one side, in that I was doing dancing. I was a professional dancer for 11 and a half years, and that was the side that my parents and my family knew, and then the other side that my peers knew was that I was kind of a devilish Dr. Jekyll, Mr. Hyde, running around late at night and committing burglaries and doing drugs and drinking and cavorting around with the so-called bad crowds. When I reached my 21st birthday, I was just a cauldron pot ready to explode, and consequently that's what happened, was I exploded.
There's a group out here in Marin County that goes into San Quentin prison every Wednesday night into the minimum security part of the prison. And there's a group that goes in now to the maximum security part every Thursday night. In dealing with these people for the last 2 years, I have seen tremendous change in some of these people who are in prison. Obviously not all of them, but some of them.
The Course started letting me get peace, letting me relax, and I started experimenting with the lessons that I was picking up and trying them out on people, and I started getting real warmth and closeness and in touch with people. When they hurt, I hurt, not out of sympathy, but out of empathy. I could understand more clearly, having experienced the pain and the degradations and the things that go on in prison, and not pointing fingers at that's their fault. You know, they did that to me, society did that to me, The jury did that to me, the judge did that. I was real clear now that, you know, I did that to me. I allowed myself to become unconnected. I allowed myself to be unloving and unavailable and resentful and bitter and things like that. Once I got that, then it was real clear that it was okay to tell somebody that, you know what, I love you, and be in prison at the same time.
I like to say that, you know, personally, that it gives me peace of mind when I don't worry about other things that go on around me, and I try not to make no judgment as to what somebody else does or nothing. You know, even what somebody else says, I don't even make no personal judgment of it. I used to, because it used to affect me. Why you say, well, that person is wrong, or just, you know, he made a bad judgment. Right now, I don't even, you know, even really care. Whatever they do is their business, and, you know, whatever they say is their business. And I try to just shut my ears out to what I don't want to hear. And what I don't want to affect me, if I feel it's going to affect me, I just shut my ears out to it and I say, it's none of my business. Just wham, bam, just keep my own inner peace, just like that.
Rather than turn them off, which I used to do, now I try to listen to them and try to help them out. Because whatever I put out is going to come back. If I help him out, I can help me out, and I'll be better in handling their problem later. Meanwhile, at that time, there will be something constructive going on. For instance, I say, hey, you may be right, he's cussing me out for something he said that I do. You may be right, let me think about that. That takes the onus off. That takes a little bit of the pressure off, so this guy can cool off a little bit. Or I'll find some other, I'm just using that for example. But it's important that I try to help him out.
I put myself in that frame of looking right at him, because he was who I was actually mad at, and repeated it over and over to myself that I could have peace, and I could give myself peace in the situation, and I felt a lot more relaxed. I really did, and it brought. I don't feel as mad as I did before. I'll put it that way. I feel a little different. I still have a little bit of hostility in me, but I still have to. Work with it more, you know. I'm new to it. He just had me so uptight.
What the Course does for a lot of people is to get them to know, recognize, almost instantly, that they are not acting the way they want to, and they can change their minds because they are aware of that. And that is as much of a help as anything, because it stops you from going in a direction that you inherently really don't want to do. You don't want to be conflicted. Nobody wants to be conflicted. They want to be loving, and they want to love. And if it stops you from being conflicted, which is what it does for an awful lot of people who study this course.
The Course in Miracles, through the concepts of teaching love and forgiveness, bring forth a man when he walks back into society who wants to give that love, who knows that that's what he'll be getting back. Whatever he gives, he'll be getting back.
Love, through the Course, is it became a lot more unconditional, a lot more without restrictions or barriers or reservations about whom I give it to, how I give it to them, how often I give it to them, were there strings attached, were there no strings attached. Just a real unconditional feeling of goodness, of peace, of the only right thing to do was to love, regardless of what somebody would say or do or whatever their act was about, whether it was in prison or not, whether he was a guard or not, whether he was a free person or not, whether it was my primary relationship with my wife or not. Love just became very unconditional.
Society often wants these men to be punished and wants to ostracize them and keep them locked up forever. First of all, most of them are not going to be locked up. They're going to come back out into the society. What we feel is very crucial is what kind of men or women come back to the society. Are they people that are now have seen the error of their way? Have they eliminated the things that have motivated them, the guilt and so forth? Can they eliminate those thoughts that makes them even want to be criminal? Can we make a difference so that they don't want to slide back into the cocaine world or the heroin world, then from that world striking at society or showing their anger or their revenge?
Atonement to me means being able to live with myself and having gone through a period of not feeling good about that, I think the Course allowed me to get comfortable now with what I choose to share. And I think that what I choose to share now and what I believe my purpose is in that sharing is my experiences, my life, teaching, as it were, that it is okay to love, that it is okay to relinquish barriers and obstacles to love's presence, to allow yourself to experience your fear, because you're not going to die from it. And I'm still working on atonement. Little things keep cropping up now and from the past that I had forgotten about, conveniently. And forgiving myself and continuing the atoning process, to get clean, to be cleansed, to be clear, and to be able to communicate that clarity. The course, bottom line, is besides peace of mind and direction, is like inner strength. And it's about the determinations and the responsibilities and the challenges that we have in life. And they're all real, and yet they're all illusionary.
One of the things I've learned from working with clients in psychotherapy is that they tend to get better when they take responsibility for their experience. And the course speaks to this very directly. It says simply, I am responsible for what I see. I choose the feelings that I experience, and I decide upon the goal I would achieve. And everything that seems to happen to me, I ask for and receive as I have asked. Now, that's quite a challenge if we're going to accept that at face value. But in fact, it gives us a sense of direction. It points out to us that we need to take responsibility for the feelings we have, and that if I'm angry, at some level that's a choice. It may be out of defensiveness, it may be out of fear, but that basically I can choose whether I want to release that anger, to work it through and move on, or whether I want to remain stuck in it, so to speak. And I think that's sometimes a problem, because in psychotherapy, we often emphasize the importance of expressing anger, but we forget that that's not an end point. When a person feels like a victim, it's maybe very appropriate for them to get angry about it, but it's also appropriate for them to release that and to move on, so that in order to get in touch with our creativity, to be truly creative rather than reactive in our lives, we need to get beyond the position of victim and the position of adversary and angry reactivity into a more creative view of what's possible in our lives, to really decide on the goal that I would achieve and to recognize that freedom of choice. Because as the Course says, we need to acknowledge that we are already free.
A lot of the Course is about living in the world in a different way. Also, a lot of it's about guilt. Two of the things, obviously, that cause the greatest degree of guilt in all of us here are sex and money. And while the Course takes positions on nothing, the Course is not a system of behavior. The Course is a system of mind changing. Really, I think what it has taught me regarding those two subjects is that sex and money are neutral things in which I invest my meaning. Like everything else in the world, the body, the world itself, sex, money, whatever else it would happen to be, each thing only has the meaning that my mind gives it. If I make sex a very important thing to me and make it something that I need, I'm giving power to sex that sex doesn't have. If I make money something very important to me, which I did for a good portion of my life, then I make money something that it really isn't. And I think the easiest way to say it is this. The Course in Miracles teaches you to live in the moment. In order to live in the moment, you have to do a couple of things. You must forgive so that you can trust. You must have no defenses so you don't feel that you're going to be attacked. But assuming that you can go through the sequence of no defenses, forgiveness of your brother for what he didn't do to you, and then trust, and you can live in the moment, then all those things become meaningless. Money becomes meaningless because living in the moment is the whole point. Money is a future-oriented thing. Sex becomes something that you do or you don't do. If it's there and you should do it, you do it. If it's not there and you don't do it, you don't do it. It doesn't become something that's more important than it should be. And unfortunately for us, way back for the story of Genesis on through the world, sex has become something that's almost like the serpent. We should hate the serpent. We should hate sex. We should feel guilty when we have sex. We should feel guilty if we have too much money. We should feel guilty if we have too little money. That's kind of absurd. So I think what the Course has taught me to do is to take one step back from those emotion-ridden things and recognize that the emotion that's in there, I put in there, and I can subtract it out. And then in doing so, I can see it in balance. And I think if there's anything that the Course would teach us over a long period of time is to become in balance.
The Course is very definite about what the body cannot do. It says bodies try to join and to unite, and they can't. A body is a tool for communication, and the best it can do is to try to join with that thought in mind. Hence, bodies will always be separate, minds never. We are one in mind. That which we do with our bodies is sometimes very suspect, And there's a lot of bad history involved. Anywhere from killing it to using it against somebody else in anger, including sex. We also overfeed it. We mutilate it. We paint it. We prune it. We get very involved in the looks of it and the management of it. And we forget who we really are. This is the ego's idol, the body. A Course in Miracles is not against joy. It's not against happiness. It's not against peace. It rather suggests that what we use the body for is very important. And the question that's raised over and over again in a student's mind of the Course is ask, what is this for? What is the meaning of everything one does? If it's for joining in the mind, if it's for demonstrating love, if it's for inclusion, if it's for sharing, then it's for love, and one will feel peace. If it's for the opposite, one will feel only discomfort and pain.
And so sexuality is sometimes an expression of this desire for joining. But the real work is to recognize that we are, in fact, already one, that we are joined at the level of spirit, that we are one mind, and that when we recognize ourselves in each other, when we recognize the Christ light within each other, then we truly acknowledge our oneness. And it is in this joining that healing occurs. The Course says that healing occurs when two minds recognize their oneness and become glad. It also says that all healing is release from fear, and that all healing is release from the past. That in fact, we need to recognize what we already know. Today, when so many people are concerned with the search for enlightenment, and the Course reminds us that enlightenment is but a recognition, not a change at all.
Part of my work as a clinician in this county was consulting with oncologists with children who had very serious illness and were dying. And I noted that many of these children oftentimes asked the doctor or nurse, this is way back now in 1975, about their thoughts about dying and their fears about dying, and oftentimes the nurse and the doctor would just change the subject. And it occurred to me there needed to be a place where kids could really talk and have an honest reaction, because oftentimes those same kids would find the person who was the most honest was the woman who was scrubbing the floor, and she would give an honest response. And I gave a lecture back in New York on the prevention of cancer and talking about some of the things I was doing on a one-to-one basis, really utilizing Course principles. And what occurred to me was I was to start, it was sort of like in my meditation on the plane coming back, I was to start a center that would make use of the Course principles that would allow me to look at death differently. And really the children would teach me these spiritual principles. And I was just to be the catalyst for setting it up. And I set it up really based on the Course principles, not saying to children, look, I have a better way of dealing with this than someone else, but I'd like your help. Can we be colleagues with each other about a different way of looking at the world? And maybe it would be possible if you got together with other children and could talk with them about their problems, you could end up helping each other far better than doctors and nurses and teachers. And so we started in that way. The name Center of Attitudinal Healing actually makes use of many of the principles of the Course in Miracles, because what is attitudinal healing except letting go of the negative thoughts of fear and anger and attack thoughts and having them be replaced with love that's always been there. So this is what really attitudinal healing is all about. And that's how the center started in 1975. I thought maybe it would last about a year, and it continued to grow. We began seeing not only children, we began seeing brothers and sisters of children with cancer, and the parents and uncles and aunts and grandparents. And then we began seeing adults with the catastrophic illness. Please, get away from any kind of guilt you'd have, so you're really free to make new decisions. Wouldn't that help a lot?
There are now over 40 centers around the country, in this country and in other countries, the centers of attitudinal healing.
I did say sir, because he was a sergeant.
I began going around talking about love and God, some things that we don't talk about in medical school. But the majority of doctors, they became very skeptical, very concerned, very wondrous. But what happened was that the families that we were seeing, children who had catastrophic illness, that there was such rapid shifts in their feelings. Their whole family structure had changed so rapidly that these very physicians that were very skeptical began to refer people to us. A couple of years later, the American Medical Association came out and wrote an article about us on their front page of the newspaper that goes to 90,000 doctors, and it was a very positive article. And we began receiving letters from doctors and nurses from all over the country. So there's been a real shift in the perception about our work. And one of the things that's been helpful to me is a quote from the Course that says, "I'm not a body, I am free, for I'm still as God created me. The peace of God is everything that I want. The peace of God is my one goal, the aim of all my living here, the end I seek, my purpose, my function, and my life, while I abide where I'm not at home." And children at the center have really been greatly helpful to me at taking another look at the body and seeing the difference between life and death. One child who had sickle cell anemia named Kerry, I was asking him about what he thought about death. He'd come close to death many times. He said, "Well, Jerry, I think what happens when you die is that God has really created a library, and you're a book in his library. And what he does is he loans this book to your parents, and it's on a loan basis. And when the due date is up, that book comes back into God's heart. So you're never really separate from God. And when your time's up, you just go home to the heart of God." And I thought, wow, what a beautiful way of looking at it.
Sometimes we find ourselves in situations at the Marine Mammal Center where we suddenly see relationships that we have with each other, with these animals, with the whole planet Earth, that we're all joined, that there really are no separations. And I look at it that the opportunity to work with these animals, the opportunity to work in the healing process, is a healing process for ourselves and an energizing factor in how this place attracts people to come and work here and be a part of it.
Come on, Bailey.
Right here.
And all healing is a release from the past. From past perceptions, illusions of the past, I see in my own life a tremendous growth, especially over the last few years as I've been studying the Course in Miracles, that I've come to a point that I am at least able to see the baggage I'm dragging behind me and realizing that it's my choice to release that. And that in releasing those illusions, and they are illusions because the past is over, it can touch us not, and the future is not, nothing exists but the present now, this holy instant now. And once one gets that, there's just a tremendous power because there, you are defenseless. There is no need to feel vulnerable to the world that you're joined with. And it's a wonderful healing process, and I think when we mirror that to each other, it's non-stoppable. We're all in this together, whether we're doing our work here at the Marine Mammal Center or wherever we're working and wherever we're joining with people, and it's just marvelous. You know, in relationship to the work we do with the animals, and as they come into us here, we give them names and we see the various personalities as we perceive them in each other or whatever. But the bottom line is, in our releasing them back out to sea, when we put them out into the wild, I think that's where I see the ultimate joining. It's unconditional love. And if we could only learn how to perfect this with each other, getting beyond the personalities, beyond all the things that can interrupt on a day-to-day basis, and realize that joining is there, and I see it when those animals go back out into the wild. You know, I need not know where they're going or where their next fish is going to come from or whatever. I only need to know that I am connected with them in a very unique way. And in the way that I am connected with them, I am connected with my brother and with every living thing on this planet. And the more I can raise my consciousness to identify with that without having to define it, what it is, the more I think I come close to an understanding of what the life force is that moves us and what truly can affect changes among people, to just realize that joining. And when we try to define it, I think that's when we start to push away and separate.
The Course says that every opportunity properly perceived is an opportunity to heal. Every situation properly perceived is an opportunity to heal. So that it means that we can take our psychological and spiritual work out of the consulting room into the world and that in fact, as we begin to change our perception of the world, our experience changes too. Because the Course is not about learning a new intellectual thought system. It's about experience. And it says that a universal theology is impossible, but a universal experience is not only possible, but necessary.
I come from a Jewish family in Transylvania, which is the Hungarian-speaking part of northwestern Romania. I grew up in a town which was 100% Hungarian, and where the Jews were an important minority. I come from a family that was quite wealthy, quite highly regarded, and yet were all very religious Jews. On the way to school and on the way back from school, almost daily, I got beaten up as a child because I was a Jew. I looked just like they did, I talked like they did, and they both beat me up because I was a Jew. I remember when I first saw an SS officer. I was not 13 or just turned 13, and I could not understand why anyone would have a uniform which was decorated with a skull and crossbones, as the SS did. They worshiped death. What was even more difficult for me is that they spoke German. And my grandmother, who was dearest of all to me, was of German-speaking heritage in Transylvania. She could barely speak Hungarian. And to me, the German language and the German culture represented her. And she was the kindest, the loveliest, the lovingest woman in the world. And she was the one that, among others, was murdered in Auschwitz. At that time, we tried to get ourselves papers, which in case of an escape of some sort would serve to save our lives, namely that we were not Jews. And a Catholic priest who took his life in his hands for doing this agreed to christen us and give us papers as if we had been cradle-born Christians. And that was, even though I was not religious, so-called, I realized much later that it was a terribly traumatic experience for me. It was a total betrayal of my grandfather and grandmother. And so when the war was over, I was carrying all sorts of guilt. First, I found out what had happened to the family that had remained in Transylvania. We were in Romania proper. And all those were delivered to the concentration and then extermination camps. So 66% of our family were killed there. We who survived had to live with the guilt of having survived, perhaps because we had those false papers, perhaps because we turned our backs on our own kindred folk. And I had some major problems to deal with. One day it dawned on me that the Nazis didn't only almost destroy me by destroying most of my family, but that they left me with an incurable disease of hatred. And I didn't want that anymore. And that is perhaps that which made me stay in the course, in spite of the terms which bothered me no end, in spite of the concepts which were terribly difficult for me to deal with and to be with, because I wanted to have peace, I wanted to have happiness. And I thought, or had some kind of an instinct, that the Course would lead me out of this terrible impasse I was in. And the Course, in fact, did. Two things happened for me. One of them was that I discovered that every time I forgave just a little bit, something happened within, and I became less unhappy, at least. And so as I was forgiving the little Nazis, I was able to forgive the bigger Nazis and the bigger Nazis. And then in the end, I was able to forgive even Hitler.
But I think what the Course would suggest, whether it's talking about somebody who's been brutally raped, or somebody whose family or member of a family has been brutally raped or killed, whether one's talking about the victims of the Holocaust or the starving people in Ethiopia or whatever that form in the world, is would not ask us to deny what we are seeing, not ask us to deny the pain that our bodies are going through, but would ask us to look at it through the eyes of the Holy Spirit, who would then teach us that regardless of what seems to be happening to us, that everything in this world is a learning lesson. There's a workbook lesson that says all things are lessons God would have us learn. And that the lesson for me, whether I'm a victim or I'm a victimizer, is that despite the seeming differences of our body and the seeming differences that our perceptions tell us, that we all remain still as God created us, and that we are all separated, and that we all have to return home together. And this, of course, would be a glaring difference between the Course's view of, quote, evil and sin in the world and the way most people in the world see it.
There is a prayer or invocation in the text which goes somewhat like this. I give you to the Holy Spirit as part of myself. I know that you will be released unless I want to use you to imprison myself. In the name of my freedom, I choose your release because I recognize that we can be released together. And I add my own only in there, that we can be released only together. And whenever I am in a place where I'm fixed on something that someone did to me, or judge someone, or have trouble to let go of anything, I make use of that invocation and see them in fact being released along with me. I have a visual image, inward visual image of that. And it has worked miracles for me.
When I started to read A Course in Miracles and recognized that to forgive is to overlook, that selective remembering helped in the process of forgiveness. To choose only the thoughts of love and forget those of aggression, fear, denial, anger. That in that attitude, based upon a spiritual concept, that we are not our bodies, but we are in truth spirit. At that point, I could understand what the Course meant when it said, to forgive is not to condone, it's not to make error real, but rather to recognize that what you thought someone has done to you has never in truth occurred. Has never in truth occurred was so startling to me because of course it occurs. We see it every day. We experience it every moment. But in truth, it's saying, in the metaphysical reality, in the spiritual truth, in God's world, it has not occurred. Only by shifting our thought from the ego's thought system to that of God can we dare to accomplish forgiveness. That's the bad news. The good news is we have a friend, the voice within us, the eternal forgiver, the higher guide, the higher self, anything we choose to call it. And it's that great transformer within, that helps in the process of forgiving. So it became then very, very specific, the guidelines I was given for forgiveness. Number one, recognize I had a problem, that I wasn't feeling peaceful, and that I was holding a negative feeling about someone. Recognize it, bring it to the surface, confront it. All within myself, of course. And the second, recognize that I wanted peace, that I really wanted to see it differently, that I wanted to change my mind. I didn't want to hold this grudge, this grievance, any longer. Number three, know that I couldn't accomplish this by myself, meaning my small self, my ego self. Number four, turn it over to the higher self. Say, take this mess, I can't handle it. I really surrender it to you. I ask you to take it from me and to show me what true vision is. Now, when that happens, one can be sure that the situation is transformed, that one does see with different eyes. I call it realize. I begin to realize what that other human being is to me, more than a brother or a sister, more than a friend. That person is myself. In that sense, I am not my brother's keeper. I am that other. No one can do anything to one's self when one is looking at the world through one's higher self. And that becomes a system of such safety and protection that it has great dividends.
I had worked in the White House with a very peculiar assignment. I was a writer. under the administration of President Ford, and I was editorial liaison officer between Ford, Kissinger, and the National Security Council. And my job was to advocate the defense budget and the military weapons that were seen as required. In other words, to spread fear. My assignment also was to write the president's religious speeches, love one another. I saw something of a dichotomy. And I also saw what was actually going on within government and in international affairs. I became so troubled by this that by the time I left the White House with the election of President Carter, I turned to prayer and meditation. And then the Course of Miracles appeared, delivered to me by Judith Scutch.
At the time I received the Course, in 1978, I had been given a job by the Joint Economic Committee of Congress to look out into the 80s and try to describe the nature of the evolution or revolution in American values that would take place. And so I had a lot of advisors, a committee drawn from many different fields outside of the library, and we explored this, and it was for the first time that I suppose I had ever looked seriously at the notion of a kind of collective American consciousness, because my life had really been dedicated to foreign and foreign defense policy issues. I was much more interested in China and the Far East and Europe and so forth. So I just took our country for granted. It was in the context of that work that I really became depressed. In effect, not only was I having a personal crisis in my life with my frustrated search for meaning, for personal meaning, but in my professional life, as I was working with these people surveying where America was going, I began to encounter signals, evidence of a profound alienation among ourselves, American to American, alienation between Americans and some of their oldest institutions, and a kind of crisis of confidence and of identity that was emerging, not only in this country, but in Europe.
The Course can't bring peace to the world. People can bring peace. First, inner peace. First, peace within self. First, to apply the principles inwardly before anything can happen externally. Peace in relationships with those near and close, emotionally, with the co-workers, the transformation of personal relationships in one's own neighborhood, in one's community, that will lead to a movement in the world. But I do feel that the people in government, policymakers, are loaded with fear. Now, fear is it dealt with great insight by the Course. That the entrapment by fear and the necessity to transmute that fear into love, into understanding and compassion for others. What can be a teaching instrument for the individual could be applied on a national scale. But first, the leadership of a nation is only a mirror image of the citizens. And when enough citizens begin opening and changing and seeing without fear, forgiving and loving, we can have a national change.
One of the questions that's often asked about the Course is, does it have any relevance for dealing with the really big problems of our time, the fact that human survival and our planet are threatened? And I think that the answer is yes, particularly if we look at our global problems and realize that all of them, whether they be population growth or starvation or pollution or nuclear weapons, for the first time in our history, each and every one of the major threats we're facing is human-caused, and hence they come from our own behavior and therefore from our own ways of thinking and perceiving and acting and relating to one another. In other words, what this means is that what we've thought of as our global problems are global symptoms, and they're symptoms of our individual and collective psychology and spiritual attitudes and behavior. And it's interesting that the Course, which aims to help us relate more lovingly to one another, to let go our limiting belief systems about the fact that we wouldn't be able to make an impact or make a difference, that it works to empower us in the world and with ourselves, all of the things the Course aims at doing actually also tackle and try to and tend to heal the psychological spiritual roots which underlie not only our own suffering but the suffering and troubles of the world as well. And we can
gather and talk. As we all, a large body of people, began studying A Course in Miracles, there were those whose language was not English. And as they became more and more interested in and dedicated to learning this belief system, they felt the need to put it into their own language. So it would be really various individuals, self-appointed, who felt he or she had the skill to do this job, came forward and identified themselves and said, this seems to be what I am being inner guided to do. Would it be all right if I put this material into my own language? Well, of course it's all right, but who was to watch over it and who was to help guide it through its process? I almost forgot that it wasn't to be human, but rather the source, which gave it in the first place.
Does that have a connotation, of a spatial connotation?
The Course is now being translated into almost a dozen languages. A great deal of loving attention is being given as each word, each phrase is discussed, alternatives come into view, they're discarded perhaps or used, but with great deal of care, it's evolving. I sometimes think that Central Casting has an incredible sense of humor to put people like us in the position of helping birth this along, since we have absolutely no qualifications whatsoever for the job. But I guess that's just to reinforce the belief system that with God, all things are possible.
Le miracle réel, c'est l'amour qui les inspire.
תמיד חוזרת למחשבה. מי ביושר פשוט, ללא התגוננות ורמייה עצמית.
Los santos compañeros que van contigo, te darás cuenta de que no hay tal viaje, sino solo un despertar.
Bitten Sie um die Liebe, die Sie heilen würde, aber die Sie sich selbst vorenthalten.
In London, at Westminster Abbey, May 1985, 10 years after A Course in Miracles was first published in the United States. At the invitation of Lillian Carpenter, wife of the Dean of Westminster Abbey, a new edition of A Course in Miracles was launched for Great Britain. Lillian, it absolutely astounded me last year in May when we came over to London to participate in the launch of the British edition of A Course in Miracles. And we sat here in this magnificent Jerusalem chamber. You told us something that startled me so much that I had chills up and down my spine. I didn't realize that the King James Version of the Bible was translated in this room. Mm-hmm. And it seemed extraordinarily appropriate. And there are other translations done here too, weren't there?
Mm-hmm. Yes, the King James's and the Presbyterian Book of Common Prayer began here. And also the Modern Translation, which is also incredible that it should all come here. And when we have the Scottish people in here, we make them roar with laughter when we say, well, yours all started here.
What do you think the significance is of having the launch of A Course in Miracles here in this room? I had no idea it was going to happen.
No, I know. It's a miracle that it happened.
Yeah, but how? But what is the significance to you of it happening in this particular place? Jerusalem, City of Peace.
Well, I think, first of all, we were lucky that we were here, and Edward was dean.
That's right.
That was the first consolation.
We were lucky.
And then the second thing is that I'd had several groups here reading The Course of Miracles, and when I heard that the paperback was coming out, what more wonderful place than here in Jerusalem Chamber, where these early translations, and it seemed to me as though it was a continuing of the message, but bringing it fresh and new, the same wonderful message, but in The Course of Miracles set out in the way it is. Yeah. And this emphasis on love, which I feel is so important. And we speak so much about love in words, but it's how we use the word. It's something that we feel, and in The Course of Miracles, this brings it home to us so very much. And Bill, you know so much about this.
Well, the Course expresses it very simply when it says, teach only love, for that is what you are.
What you are, yes, yes.
And we begin to recognize that as we begin to teach what we want, then it becomes much more a part of us.
Yes, yes. But yet it's got to be expressed through this body, hasn't it? This is sometimes the drawback, isn't it?
It seems to
be. We make barriers around ourselves.
But we can also go beyond them. Mm. And in that phrase, teach only love, for that is what you are, first time I heard that, I had to stop and think, what does that mean, that's what you are? Mm. And then, of course, when you get beyond the feeling that the body is all you are and it's all you have, and recognize there is more, and that's within, then that's what you can extend.
I think it's something that you have to struggle with all the time, with yourself, this transformation. And to me, anyway, it is an individual, personal thing, I think, for every one of us. And it may be very easy for some and not so easy for others, but I believe it's an ongoing thing. It's every moment, it can be a moment to express this and to feel it and to know it, that it's alive. It is something that's living, it's real. It's difficult to, I believe, to put your finger on it, to write about it, but Helen did.
When the course began in 1965, Helen and I were naturally curious as to why it had come into our lives at that time. And we received a special message which said essentially that the world was in an increasingly difficult and deteriorating situation, and that there was a celestial speed-up underway.
And that, lovely remark,
isn't it?
Yeah. Celestial speed-up.
And that we were asked to play our part in this celestial speed-up, as many other people were. Our part was to do this particular assignment, which involved A Course in Miracles.
And it also said, didn't it? I remember Helen telling me that this was only one of many ways.
Many
ways. A Course in Miracles starts, but this is A Course in Miracles, it is a required course.
Yes.
But it doesn't mean that this is the only way in the world.
No,
it means rather the greater course of learning who we are in truth.
Yes. This word speed, can you say that sentence again?
The celestial speed up?
The celestial speed up. Now, this is what I believe is happening. Years and years ago, this couldn't have happened. We'd either been put in the fire or tortured in some way for bringing out this wonderful book, Course in Miracles. But I believe the time is ripe. All over the world, in every corner of the earth, there's someone reawakening. And we don't know what this speeding up has done within us, because we are able now to accept it, which we wouldn't have been able to do even 40 years ago, 30 years ago, we wouldn't. Do you think that, Bill? What do you think about that?
Well, certainly I would not have been prepared.
There's no question of that.
No. Certainly nor I.
No, I think there was some kind of evolution in world consciousness in the middle 60s, which perhaps made this particularly appropriate.
So I think this one of time, it is the right time. It's come at the right. Now, whether it can transform, we know it can transform. We don't ask whether it will or can. It will transform. many, many lives all over the world. I'm absolutely certain of that.
Well, we know that as we change our minds, other people are helped to change their minds. And this is the kind of chain reaction which takes place.
Yes, the change has taken place in ordinary people. Yeah, that's without any political thing at all. The ordinary person in the street is changing, and the time is ripe for this to be received by them.
I think the Course says this very effectively. The mind that means that all it wants is peace must join with other minds, for that is how peace is obtained. And I think this expresses the spirit of joy and peace that is a constant theme throughout the Course. And I think this is part of the joining that we're all experiencing and the joy that goes with that joining.
I want the peace of God. To say these words is nothing, but to mean these words is everything. The mind that serves the Holy Spirit is unlimited forever. In all ways, beyond the laws of time and space, unbound by any preconceptions, and with strength and power to do whatever it is asked.